Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Triangulation, episode 294, recorded Monday, April 17th, 2017. Games for Change. Triangulation is brought to you by Betterment, a smart, easy-to-use, and less expensive way to invest for your financial future. Get 1 month managed free when you make an initial deposit of $10,000 or more at betterment.com/triangulation. And by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at quickenloans.com/triangulation. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get together with some of the most interesting people in technology and we learn, and you're the third angle on the triangle, the third side of the triangle. If you are watching live, you could join us in the chat room at irc.twit.tv. Your reactions and questions and thoughts are, of course, always welcome. This is a really interesting subject today. Asi Burak is joining us. He is a video game designer and very engaged in the idea of using games to change the world. Asi, welcome. Good to talk
to you. Thank you.
His new book is called Power Play, How Video Games Can Save the World. Asi, as his master's thesis, was it game design at CMU that you were studying?
Yeah, I mean, it was related to video games. It's called entertainment technology.
It's such a great major. And it makes sense that CMU would have such a cool major.
Yeah, because it's a combination of art and engineering, you know.
Well, and that's what I found interesting about our Power Play is it attaches a dignity and an importance to video games that often are not attached. Usually they're games, right? They're for kids stuff. But in fact, video games,
it's the perception.
Yeah. It's the perception, it's not the actual reality. First of all, many of us older folks play video games. In fact, far more middle-aged men play video games than anybody else. You started as a kid. You were a video game addict when you were little.
Yeah, you know, I'm from the generation that started with Atari. So from the very start of the video games revolution, through arcade games, then, you know, the first Apple, the first PC, I owned the first Mac in 84. So yeah, I mean, I played games from the very beginning and saw them evolve.
When did your point of view about games change?
I was always in favor of games, and actually some of the games I played in the 80s were very advanced in terms of the themes, you know, in terms of how meaningful and serious they were. It was interesting that when technology was limited, some people took them to, you know, even in text, to very interesting places. However, when in the 2000s, when I started really designing and being involved with tech, I got this insight that we're barely scratching the surface. And then I came to the Carnegie Mellon and to the United States, and I saw that I'm not the only one that thinks like that, but part of a relatively small group, you know, and small community. And since then, I was involved with this community and saw it grow significantly.
Actually, you make a good point, because I think back to the early days of Atari games. One of my favorite games was learning to run a nuclear reactor.
Yeah.
You know, even Civilization was as much, you know, had an element of history and learning to it, that something like Call of Duty, it's much less of a, or even worse, Grand Theft Auto, much less of an educational game, right?
I mean, it's different mechanics. I think that, you know, making a very realistic shooter makes a lot of sense now in the age of 3D realism and, you know, very quick response time. I mean, those games are also, it's funny to say teaching, but they definitely have their own way of improving skills in a player, but they're very different than a simulation. And in the early days of games, you see those games today, obviously, as well. But, you know, you had SimCity, you had balance of power around the Cold War. You had games that were all about the brain, you know, all about the representation of the world was very minimal, while the engine, the brain of the game were very advanced.
It almost seems like you could go two ways with video games, and that game companies have a choice. There's people like Chris Crawford, who must have been somewhat of an influence. We're talking about Scram. Deem picked up on Scram, which was one of his early simulation games. But he did Eastern Front. He did a number of games that were designed as much to teach you things as they, you know, as they were to just have fun. And then there's the other side of it. I won't name names, but it seems that some game developers really seem almost as a money machine. They've figured out that you can use, sad to say, human psychology and addiction psychology to make games something that just you can't put down, and you keep putting money into. And it almost seems like you could choose to go one of two ways, for good or for evil. I'm sure it's not quite so binary. But it does feel that way. I'm glad to see that there are still people around like Chris Crawford. I realize Internet Archive offers Scram as an emulator. I got sucked into it.
Very cool.
Isn't it fun, though, to see this again? Well, you must have. Were you influenced by Chris Crawford?
I was definitely influenced by Balance of Power, and that's Chris Crawford's game.
Yeah.
And it was interesting, you know, a few years ago, he came to Games for Change and, you know, kind of to see the legend, you know. And we also brought Sid Meier in another event just last year.
Yeah.
And Will Wright was speaking. So, you know, these guys, I think their greatness is that for them, it's not even, is it educational? Is it about education? It's just a piece that... You know, just like Schindler's List or Argo or, you know, any movie that is just, you don't even need to define it. It's just a piece that engages you on so many levels. It's engaging, it's fun, it's informative, it's meaningful, it changes your mind about the world. You know, that's I think, what great game designers can do today.
Yeah. In a way, it's making games much more important than just some silly little thing. And so tell us a little bit. I want to show, before we talk about Games for Change, and we're, of course, the book Power Play, I want to show your master's thesis, which was a game called Peacemaker. So Peacemaker starts with video, going way back to 1922.
Right.
Here's the founding of Israel in 1948.
Showing you the cycle of violence that basically goes on and on. You know,
just the 7-day war in 1967. Yeah. What a troubled area this has been. But then I love it because after you, oh dear, is that Entebbe? Oh, it's just terrible stuff.
This was the TWA kidnapping of the planes to Jordan.
Right. Oh my. So, but the, I mean, you don't normally start video games with this kind of stuff, except it sets the ground, it sets the scene for what is really an interesting game. You have to choose whether you're going to be the president of the Palestinian Federation or the prime minister of Israel. And you're working not to beat the other guy, but to be a peacemaker. Something that has, this is a challenge that has defeated the best minds of several generations now. And I love it. It's available on iOS if you guys want to play it for $1.99. So tell me about Peacemaker and what your goal was in Peacemaker.
So Peacemaker was you see how the game is built and how it's designed. It's a strategic game that, you know, gives you the ability to make very high level decisions, and your decisions are going to impact the environment. This is the first video when you choose the Israeli side, when you basically joins the office, and it's all based on real footage from the prime minister offices. And your real goal is to, on one hand, to you know, make Israel secure and make the people of Israel happy and satisfied. The other end, build the quality of life with the and trust with the Palestinians. And right from the beginning, what you're showing now, we're showing you what we call the inciting incident.
A suicide bomber kills 18 and injures 100 in West Jerusalem.
Yeah, and we want to tell you, look, it's not going to be a kumbaya, and it's not a game about it's a game about peacemaking with very, very intense challenges.
You have various things you can do. This is, you know, I wish we could get world leaders to play games like this. Is that part of the goal here? Is to make people aware of the issues, but also to kind of raise their awareness of how difficult this is?
Absolutely. And, you know, we got feedback. Some we expected and some was very new to us. But, you know, we got feedback from people that said, now I understand what it means to be a leader.
How hard it is.
Yeah. It's challenging. And, you know, I heard things like, oh, but they don't understand. I'm actually, my intentions are positive. You know, why is the opposition... why they're fighting me? So you have this kind of complexity that the game, I think, is doing a pretty good job in conveying. And also it does a good job in connecting the dots between actions and consequences, between stakeholders and their agenda. You understand the poles and how they're affected by the actions that you're taking.
Yeah. Yeah,
and you can look at the groups and leaders to see at any point. This is to your left there on the bottom. You see at any point what those guys are thinking about you, and you see over time how it's changing. You know, it's going up and down, and
this is great. And you have to take all of this into consideration. You can't
absolutely.
What is this? This is fascinating.
You know, it's like going on a tightrope, but that basically. Every decision you make is going to appease some people, but it's going to upset other groups. And the game also has a momentum. So if you reach a certain point of trust, you can start move faster, right?
How do you? I'm always curious, and you know, and you mentioned three of the great legends in simulation. But it's great to be able to talk to somebody who does this kind of stuff. How do you simulate how people are going to react to this? Do you just make it up?
So obviously it was a team effort, mm-hmm. right? We worked, we were at some points 12 people on the team. There was one guy, Tim Sweeney, that I have to give him credit for being the game designer here, that he basically constructed an engine, right? Kind of the under the hood, he constructed a system that is not rigid in the sense that it always behaves the same way, okay? He constructed a set of rules that the player's actions are going to be tested against, but in a way, it's not scripted. So if you play a game and someone else plays the same game and makes different decisions, as someone who made the game, I cannot predict what is going to happen.
Oh, interesting.
The game is as this emergent system that a few rules are actually... In interaction with each other, create a pretty sophisticated system that has its own logic, you know?
And develops over time in an unpredictable fashion.
Yeah, and obviously there are constraints. You know, we know that the settlers are going to, you know, they're going to respond in a certain way. We know that Hamas is going to respond in a certain way. But we also put some randomness inside it. Mm-hmm. And that also affects the reason it's so unpredictable, and also we have three levels. I think that you chose one of them, but we have the difficult level, that the randomness and the proactive nature of the militant groups is much higher. So it's a very intense environment, the difficult level, the level of very intense or violent.
I would love to see more of this kind of stuff. There's no reason. Why? I mean, many of the games we play, as you point out, even Call of Duty, could have components like this that would help educate people a little bit into the real world. One of the concerns a lot of people have, and I kind of have this too, even as a gamer and with, you know, kids who game, is that maybe we're isolating our children so much from the real world that gaming is developing in them kind of a perverse or even unhealthy kind of mindset, an antisocial mindset. It would be so great if we could use this to go the other direction.
Yeah, so I wouldn't, honestly, from all the information and data and you know, research that I did on my own or looked at other robust research out there, I wouldn't be much concerned. I would actually say that the video games, for you know, with kids, have a lot of benefits that many parents, unfortunately, are not aware of. And I'm not only talking about those games for change necessarily. Games are terrific tools to present systems. You know, they're about a relationship between different objects and different parts of a system. They're very good in problem solving. You know, think about it compared to TV, which you're consuming in a very passive way. It gives the kids a lot of opportunities. If a game is designed well and it's done properly, it gives a lot of opportunities for kids to be entrepreneurial, to solve problems, to get deeper into issues. So I think we're in a world that things are moving very fast, and video games succeeded very quickly in a sense, and commercial games lead the way. But I think that now we're catching up to a point where independent developers are trying different things, educators are trying different things, even the commercial companies are starting to change their tone, and that leads to the audience of video game players to be much broader than it was 5 years ago.
Go ahead. I don't want to interrupt. I'm sorry.
I'm just saying. I think that it will change the perception of the medium beyond, you know, thinking about it as there are bad games or good games, but to start seeing that this medium can do things that other media before couldn't do, because it's so interactive, it's so immersive. Of course, there are questions. You know, moderation, curation. You know, I'm working with my kids on that. You know, how long they can play a day, what games I would download for them, at what age they should even look at Call of Duty. But at the same time, I think that, you know, I feel much more confident to see them play a video game versus just sitting and watching it and staring at the TV screen.
It is definitely more interactive than that. They do have to solve problems. They do have to. In fact, nowadays, you know, I watch our 14-year-old play games. He's always playing with his friends online. It's actually a social event as much as a game.
Absolutely.
Event. Yeah, it's fascinating.
And now, I don't know how much you know and familiar with the electronic sports, with esports.
Yeah.
This is a relatively recent phenomenon in its scale. Obviously, it's something that started more than 10 years ago in Korea, but now in the US and Europe, the idea that people go to a stadium, sometimes 10,000 of them together, and watch a tournament of video games in front of their eyes in the arena and celebrating together, that's a super social activity that we didn't see in the, you know, in the age of teenagers playing video games in the basement.
Yeah, it's really interesting. I have learned about it. It kind of emerged from nowhere, and when I found out about it, I was stunned. One of our friends, Peter Bright, who writes about technology and Windows at Ars Technica, is a Dota 2 fanatic. And he likes to play, but he doesn't play at a high level. But he went to a massive event. I can't remember if it was Seattle or Vegas, of Dota
Seattle
2.
Problem.
Yeah, it was gigantic, and yeah. It seems like it's emerged out of nowhere, and it is huge. And of course, you look at Twitch TV and all the people watching and chatting while somebody's playing League of Legends and learning about the game. It has become a mass subculture. And I'm encouraged to hear you say, Asi, that it's some of it is valuable and good, because sometimes
it's maybe, definitely valuable.
Good. Okay. Thank you. I worry. You know,
it's definitely valuable. And you know, I'll give you an example of how you know, subculture is becoming mainstream, right? And it happened with Games for
exactly.
Change as well. You know,
yeah.
Over the years, those things are getting more momentum, more adoption. You know, you have a whole new generation that is growing up with video games. And as they grow up, you know, they become more influential. They become decision makers. You know, you have now people that are executives that grew up with video games. But just to give you an example of electronic sports, one of the projects that I'm involved with is advising the authority of Washington, D.C., the capital of the U.S., on sports and entertainment, on how to bring esports to D.C. And just a month ago, they announced for the first time, and I think they were the first American city to do that, that they're going to sponsor a team. So they're going to actually put money into an esports team.
Wow.
Now, the reason I'm giving that example is that this is exactly when you hit the mainstream, when a body like the government of the District of Washington, D.C. is considering it very seriously and willing even to invest. And they understand that it has value because it makes them look innovative. It drives revenue and tourism to the city. And it connects them to what's going on right now and not what happened 30 years ago.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we've been covering esports for more than a decade. I remember interviewing Thresh about, you know, he was a master of Quake. And, and you know, he played and made money playing in tournaments and so forth. But even as I've watched that evolution over the last decade, I always wondered, who wants to watch somebody play a video game? That mostly they look slack-jawed while they're playing. And unless you understand, especially if you're watching Dota 2 or League of Legends, unless you're pretty adept at understanding the game. But then I realized as a child, as a youth, I was a chess fanatic, and I would sit and watch chess games for hours.
Yeah,
if you understand what's going on, there's a lot of it's fascinating.
Now I think that chess is a great example. The other one is poker, you know, like the World Series. And I think that what we're going to see that someone in broadcast is also going to crack the way that we're presenting those stories, you know, they know how to do it for the Olympics. They know how to do it in the NFL.
Yeah. Is it the stories about the players? That's what makes the Olympics interesting, right?
It's the stories about the players, but I also think it's the presentation as well.
Yeah.
Think about poker once.
The commentary.
Once they put a camera that shows it took time to understand that the audience can actually see the
cards. Whole cam. Yeah. See what cards are in the hole. Yeah. That made a huge difference because now the audience is in on the game.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think that we didn't reach yet, because esports is relatively new, we're not yet at the point where the broadcasters are actually making it accessible enough for mid-core and even beginners. You know, it's still a very, very hardcore experience that you live stream and you just see what happens. There's no much packaging as it could be, I think.
But I think you're right. I think cities and networks are starting to realize, because they're seeing tens of thousands, sometimes hundreds of thousands of people watching these events live, and they realize, wait a minute. Do you think there'll be a time, Asi, in the next 10 or 20 years when esports will be, in effect, like the NFL or the NBA? There'll be big events that you watch on TV?
I think so. And the big question, if it will be online or on TV, that's, I think, is the only question.
Will TV survive long enough?
Yeah.
Because TV's a dying medium. We're on TV, but we're not on television. We're not on linear. Right. We're on the internet. So, yeah.
Because right now, we're already in the numbers. You know, you look at League of Legends, which is the number one game. I mean, there's no one that even comes close. But they showed in the last World Championship, over a period of a month, they showed 42 million uniques.
Wow.
So 42 million units. These are numbers that already compete with NBA.
No kidding. So maybe that's a silly question to say, will it be on TV like the NBA? Because it's, but you know, in a few years, who will the NBA be on TV like the NBA? We don't
know. Exactly.
We're talking to Asi Burak. He is a video game veteran, holds a Master of Entertainment Technology Masters from Carnegie Mellon. That's where he developed his game about Mideast peace. But he has developed many more games. He is the CEO of PowerPlay, is the chairman of the Games for Change, which we're going to talk about that in a little bit. They produce a large event in New York City, the Games for Change Festival, and the author of a brand new book called PowerPlay, How Video Games Can Save the World. And it really is a series of case studies about video games you may not have heard of, but that have made a massive difference, starting with his game, Peacemaker, but moving on to, did you know Sandra Day O'Connor has a video game? I didn't know that. We'll talk more in just a second about Power Play with Asi Burak. This is really interesting stuff, Asi. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Our show is brought to you today by Betterment, a better way to invest. Look, I'm sure you know it's part of becoming a grown-up that you got to save money for the future, right? If for the retirement, for that house you want to buy, for your kids' education. So there's not a question of whether you should be saving. It's more of how should you be investing. You're not going to put it in the mattress, and you're not going to put it in the savings account at the bank. Those just don't return enough to make it worth your time. I want to tell you about something called Betterment, which is a better way to invest for your future. It's the largest independent automated, and that's the key word here, investing service. But Betterment does some things differently I think you'll like. So the idea, of course, is with smart technology, with computer technology, you could do a better job of managing, rebalancing, keeping an eye on your investment, doing things that computers do better, like watching your money minute by minute, doing things like tax loss harvesting to lower investment taxes and increase after-tax returns. All of those things computers are really good at. But I love what Betterment's done is they've combined this smart technology with human advisors. So I think sometimes the idea that, well, I'm just going to give my money to this computer and then I'm never going to, you know, how am I going to communicate with it? That's a little scary. This is really great because you have a team of certified financial professionals and licensed financial experts. Not only are they able to talk to you and answer your questions, they continue to monitor your accounts along with the computers. And you can get planning calls and notifications throughout the year. So there's a human face on this, which I think is a great idea. Betterment, of course, uses the latest technology to create a goal-based investing framework and advice algorithm so the computer knows what your risk tolerance is, what your goals are, what your term, your time frame is. And it'll let you know if you're on track with your existing investments. It'll let you know what you need to do with your Betterment investments to maximize for what your unique individual goals are. I love it, too, that the Betterment apps and the Betterment website will let you sync in your other investments so you're not, you know, just operating in a vacuum. You know your total financial situation, your total net worth, and it takes that all into account. They make it easy for you to save with smart deposits. There's a retire guide so you can plan for your retirement, see if you have a retirement gap. It all starts at betterment.com/triangulation. And I have to tell you, because there are no trade fees, no transaction fees, no rebalancing fees, there's no minimum to sign up. This is the least expensive way for you to get global diversification, smart rebalancing, to invest. And of course, every penny that you pay in fees is a penny less you're going to earn. So low fees is part of your investing strategy. It's really important. In fact, Betterment customers can expect higher returns than a typical do-it-yourself investor. End-to-end investing, too, means faster cash transfers, tax forms available at the earliest possible date, secure investment. They've really got this down. Now, I have to remind you, as with everything in life, investment involves risk, but that's why you want to balance your investments to plan for your, you know, future, for your risk tolerance, for your time frame. Right now, you get a month managed free when you make an initial deposit of $10,000 or more. So this is a great time to roll your savings over into investment at Betterment.com. Betterment.com/triangulation. Betterment is investing made better. And we thank them so much for making this show possible. Betterment.com/triangulation. Our guest, Asi Burak, has written a new book called Power Play, How Video Games Can Save the World, with Laura Parker, who you may recognize her name from the New York Times, the New Yorker, Vanity Fair. She writes about gaming. And I think more and more, it's clear when you, from reading the book, that we're becoming aware of the power of the gaming community, both for good and bad. I think of things like Gamergate, where gamers really are, or esports, where gamers really are a powerful community, aren't they?
Now, as we discussed before, time is in our favor, right? Because there is a generational gap. There are still people that are not familiar with games or didn't grow up with games, and this is changing. You have more and more people that are, this is their maybe dominant way to express themselves, or at least one of them.
And I think that's important too, because you're not talking in about games as being preachy. In fact, you start. I love it. You start quoting Art Spiegelman, who created the great mouse. Three graphic novels about the Holocaust, about his family in the Holocaust, and it's really beautiful. It's my favorite graphic novel, and he didn't create this to preach or to teach. He created it as art. It was an expression, and so you're even saying here, this is this. You shouldn't be creating things as a way to teach or preach. This is Seinfeld. I think they said at Seinfeld, no hugging, no teaching. But you can still learn if your point is to create something amazing that people love to play, and also consider the impact that it has on the people who are playing it.
Absolutely, and you know, look, I'm definitely understanding both perspectives. You know, I understand the perspective of indie developers that, you know, they want to express themselves through a video game, and they're creating it just like you said as a piece of art and something very personal. And they're not necessarily liking to be defined or labeled. You know, they just want to communicate. But I also understand those companies or organizations that are coming in, and they're interested in seeing how video games can convey their messages, and they're willing to invest a lot of money in it, and they want to see the return. So I think that both models are completely legitimate. And as long as you are really trying to let people learn in their own pace and make their own choices, and you're not just coming top down to preach and give them solutions, I think that that's the beauty of video games. You know, that unlike the classroom in many ways, and I apologize for all the teachers, but it's not about scripts or giving solution. It's about letting people experiment, letting people make choices, letting them understand consequences.
Yeah, and as a gamer, I don't want to play a preachy game. I don't want to play an educational. No, I don't want to play it. If Chris Crawford had said Scram was an educational game about how a nuclear power plant works, wouldn't have wanted to play it. I want to play fun games. Yeah. So you're not against the idea that a game could be fun and you could learn something.
I mean, the opposite. I think that if the game is not going to be engaging, you're probably not going to do a very good job. And you know how many people, I mean, we're making fun of it, but you know how many people came to me in the past, I mean, people from outside of gaming, and they said, you know, we have the funding and we want to find a developer and make a game about nutrition, and we want to show kids what are the good food and good foods and bad foods, and you know what, that they need to choose the broccoli. I mean, it's not going to work, you know.
Yeah, nobody wants to play that broccoli game. Sorry,
not really.
Not gonna.
Not really.
So, how do you design a game that's great and fun? What should I guess? Really, in a way, this is a manifesto for the guys and gals and the companies who are designing today's top games to consider what they can do to make their games be socially responsible. Is that fair?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, the book is trying to say at any point that talent is maybe the number one ingredient. I mean, bringing the game talent. I mean, whenever I saw people coming from outside of gaming and trying to make those games that have social impact without involving talent, I mean, it's not going to work. It's like saying I'm going to make a documentary for my organization without hiring a director.
Right.
So talent is the first ingredient. I think the second one is the idea that gameplay needs to match the message or the cause or what you're trying to accomplish. Because many times people come to it and think that they're going to tell stories or dump content through a video game. And it's not about that. Video games are working differently than movies and books and theater shows in the sense that at the heart of the game, there is gameplay. There is a set of game mechanics and actions that the players can take. And, you know, if it's leverage, it's actually very appealing because you're talking about verbs. You're talking about things that the player can do. You're showing the player through action rather than telling the player what is right. And rather than have a beginning, middle, and end, you're having something that engages him in a whole different, very proactive and very actionable manner, you know?
What we're really seeing is that this is a new medium that is about to become probably the dominant medium in our society. So it's important.
If not already.
Yeah. I wonder if the same process happened when television emerged and started and became for many decades the dominant medium in society. If people were thinking in terms of its impact and what it could do and what its and most importantly, what our responsibilities are as creators.
Right. And you know, many times I'm doing those comparison, you know, just like you spoke about Art Spiegelman that we cover in the introduction to the book. I can see a lot of similar dynamics with graphic novels and how they evolved. I can see, you know, similar things with TV and how it evolved, how it became more sophisticated, more nuanced. It can speak to so many different audiences. And you have hit shows like Sesame Street that is both engaging and educational, and everybody gets it, you know? And I can speak about the evolution of film, mm-hmm. the evolution of documentaries from the 70s, or even looking at the Oscars of recent years and how many movies are there about social and political issues that go and take the biggest prizes and also get successful in the box office. Again, 50 years ago, you wouldn't have seen it. And this is just a natural process of media becoming more and more mature and diverse and having a broad appeal. Some of it has to do with business, but not only, I think. Some of it has to do, just like you said, with the responsibility of the creators.
Right. So on the one hand, people who are making games should consider what the game is teaching its players and what the game can bring to its players. And then the other hand, and a lot of the book is dedicated to people in other businesses who are trying to teach, maybe thinking about instead of making a documentary or making a video game. You talk about Sandra Day O'Connor, the retired Supreme Court justice who came on The Daily Show and said that the American public knows the judges in American Idol. They can name every one of them, but they couldn't name all the judges on the Supreme Court. What are we going to do about it? She actually was instrumental. She spoke, I know, at your Games for Change conference in 2010. And how did that come about, this iCivics game that she ended up
creating? So this is one of the best cases, I think. It's kind of, it's not a coincidence that I chose it for the second chapter right after the story of Peacemaker, because You have this Supreme Court justice that retired at the age of 78 and created this whole platform for civic education. And if someone like that is going to choose video games as the number one priority in being the tool, the vehicle for the messages, it shows you something. And the reason is that she doesn't think that the civic education right now, the system, is doing a very good job. And, you know, as much as this is under the radar in terms of public perception, like just like you said, you didn't know about it. 50% of U.S. teachers right now in social studies are using the iCivics platform.
That's
awesome. We're talking about 19 games. So not one, not two. But over time, they made 19 games on different aspects of the government. And compare a curriculum that has 19 games to a boring lesson or textbook, right?
Well, and I think there's a whole generation of people, probably most of the people watching this show, who if I mention Oregon Trail, go, oh yeah.
Absolutely.
they probably know more about the Oregon Trail than almost anything else, because when they were in school, they played a great game. It was early days of video gaming. You know, you have died. You and your party have died. And we all remember that very well.
Yeah.
It was a little after my time, but everybody I talked to, that game is very much in their mind. And so this is a great opportunity to reach kids.
Absolutely. And you know, the book, I just want to mention that, you know, we're talking a lot about awareness and education. But what the book shows is that games are now being explored and being developed in science or in medicine to do different things. So if the documentary model is about, you know, I want you to understand something or I want you to pay attention to some topic, in the science field and the medical games sometimes are about changing your behavior.
Yeah.
changing habits or even changing your brain structure. You know, there's a whole a new genre of neurogaming that are about training your brain to do other things than it used to.
Tell me about Half the Sky.
Half the Sky is a project that was one of the bigger games that I was involved with through Games for Change with Nicholas Kristof and Sherry Wudan. Nicholas Kristof and Sherry Wudan are both Pulitzer Prize winning authors. They wrote a book, Half the Sky. There was a documentary as well. And it's all about women empowerment and how integrating women in you know, all over the world, but mainly in the third world, could make a huge difference economically and in the society. And it's talking about a lot of the areas where women are not only not integrated, but they're basically oppressed with violence, with sex trafficking, with health issues. And what the game was trying to say is, you can help, you know? We'll make a Facebook game where you can understand the issues, but you can also donate money in real time. And the game was running for 3 years, and you could make actual donations to causes. So let's say that you saw, during the game, you encountered the microloans, and then you could actually donate to an organization that does it in reality.
That is really an interesting connection between the game and then the real world. That I would love to see more of that.
Yeah, and the game raised more than $500,000,
wow,
you know, to causes. And the beauty is that we could say exactly how many surgeries, for example, or how many books were donated as a result of that donation. Agree with you. I mean, it's not easy. It took a lot of coordination between the virtual and the real world to make it happen. But I hope that those models are going to become easier and more frequent in the coming years.
We're talking to Asi Burak, who is the author of a new book called Power Play, How Video Games Can Save the World. In the fourth part of your book, you talk about the tools of a new generation and particularly about virtual reality. We're going to take a break when we come back. I'd love to talk about how this next generation of gaming is going to have, the impact it's going to have. And I think it's really clear if a game can change your mind and teach you things and engage you and get you engaged in the real world, on a 2D screen, imagine what it can do if you're immersed in the game. And you have some very interesting examples in the book. We'll talk about that in just a second. But first, a word from our sponsor. And this is a sponsor I have known for a long time, Quicken Loans, one of the best lenders in the country. In fact, the Quicken Loans folks are just, they're rebuilding Detroit. They're really neat, interesting company, and very tech-focused. They understand the power of technology, and it's one of the ways they've built the number two lender in the nation and the number one lender in terms of customer satisfaction. If you look at those J.D. Power Customer Satisfaction Awards, they've been number one since 2010 for 7 years in mortgage origination, number one in mortgage servicing for the last 3 years. And now they're number one in my heart because they've created a product for us geeks, a mortgage approval process that's completely online. They call it Rocket Mortgage because it lifts the burden of the mortgage process. If you're ready to buy a house or you're ready to refi, now's a great time as interest rates start to ratchet up. Maybe it's the time to lock in a refi at a good low rate. I want you to check out Rocket Mortgage at quickenloans.com/triangulation. First of all, it's fast. Because it's all online, you're going to get approved in minutes. And it's easy for you because all of the stuff that they need, you can do electronically, whether it's pay stubs or bank statements with a touch of a finger on your phone, on your tablet, on your desktop. You could even do it as you're out and about. Let's say you go to an open house and you say, hey, I like this house. We should buy this house. Could we get a loan to buy this house? You could literally, at the open house, do the loan application, select the length of your loan, the rate of your loan, customize it to fit your needs exactly, and get approved in minutes right there and show you're approved. Show the realtor, hey, I've got a loan. Can I buy this house? I love that idea. This is using technology in a really great way. Whether you're looking to buy or refi, lift the burden of getting a home loan with Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. Skip the bank, skip the waiting, and go completely online. QuickenLoans.com/triangulation, equal housing lender. Licensed in all 50 states and MLSConsumerAccess.org, number 3030. Rocket Mortgage. Love these guys. QuickenLoans.com/triangulation. We're talking about the power of games to change the world and still be fun. We're not being preachy here. This is a book called Power Play, How Video Games Can Save the World. Our guest is its author and a guy who's been around for some time. I'm sure you know aware of him. I hope you are, from Eon Productions, where he was a strategic advisor at Tribeca, at Newsweek, McCann Erickson. He's worked on games for years. He has the best master's degree ever in entertainment technology from CMU. And he teaches right now at the School of Visual Arts MFA in Design for Social Innovation, which is really cool in New York City. Asi, it's so great to talk to you. Let's talk about the future, because virtual reality, augmented reality, we're, you know, already you're starting to change gaming, but it's in the very early days. How can this help with your mission to make the world a better place?
So, you know, the reason I'm excited, and, you know, let's put aside how long it will take, right? I think this is a big argument. Is it too soon? Is the hype, you know, is too extreme? But let's put that aside. Let's assume that it will happen in the next 5-10 years. Virtual reality is certainly an opportunity here, because it's an opportunity to have more natural interfaces. You know, and it's an opportunity because filmmakers and game makers are working on the same medium for the first time. You know, I'm already seeing it. I'm seeing a lot of experiences coming from video game makers in 3D and animation, while you see many experiences coming from filmmakers in live action. So that brings a lot of potential here. But more than anything, you know, already research shows that VR experiences have the potential to generate empathy and have the potential to get people involved with another perspective, or take you to another location in a more effective way than anything else we see in digital today.
You talk about going, you know, you can read all you want and watch all the documentaries you want about the refugee crisis, refugees camps in the Middle East. But with VR, you could do something that really would be almost impossible for a normal person to do, which is actually be in a refugee camp and see what it's like and look around and experience it. And that's where you're really, that is a powerful technology in that regard.
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the examples that I cite in the book and in my interviews is Clouds Over Sidra, which Sidra is a camp in Jordan, and it's a live-action experience. It's not even interactive in the sense that it's 360. You can walk around, but you are being guided by a little girl in the camp, and she shows you around. She shows you where her brother is playing video games. She shows you the bakery. She shows you the different tents. And look, I'm not saying it's a replacement for the real experience.
Yeah, but how many people are going to be able to go to Sidra and experience it, right?
Exactly.
So
I think it's
amazing.
Much better than just reading about it, right? It's
and even better than a film about it. I mean, you're in the camp.
You're in the camp. You can look around and think about it as it's going to become interactive, and you're actually going to interact with those characters. Again, it's not going to be stronger than the real thing, but it's going to be much stronger than anything else that could simulate or replace it.
You also talk about how education is being changed by these new technologies. For the last 7 or 8 years, there's been a program in New York called Quest to Learn, and you write about that. Tell me a little bit about that and how that's different.
Yeah, Quest to Learn is a, you know, for me, it's like a meta concept, you know, because it's not about, many times when people speak about games and education, they speak about, okay, let's create those video games that are going to be educational, they're going to be used in the classroom, we're going to talk to teachers, we're going to fight for their time, and they're going to use games as they use textbooks or lectures. Quest to Learn is doing something completely different. The whole school was designed based on game theory and based, you know, by game designers. So it's not only about digital games, it's also about paper-based games. But in the meta level, the whole curriculum and the whole progress in the school is based on games. They have boss levels, which are like the biggest test are boss levels. You know, they have quests and missions. Obviously, it's being iterated on all the time, but the beauty is that the Department of Education is behind this and was designing the school together with the people that were pioneering it. I think it's the future of education. It's just a prototype. But this level of thinking is something that we're missing, you know, kind of challenging the whole system and not only about, you know, let's bring digital products into the classroom.
I wish my kid could go there. I mean, he loves video games. If I could say, hey, your high school is designed around gaming, he would say, okay, where do I sign up? I would move to New York for doing that.
Yeah, you're going to tell him. Look, by the way, it's possible, so we can speak about it offline. But basically, you're going to tell your kid, look, your system of the school system that you're going to be in is going to be much more engaging, just like a video game is more engaging than, you know, other forms of learning. And it's designed to be more engaging. It's designed to be more adapted to your pace and your actions and your choices, just like a good video game is.
It's been around since 2009. Do you have, are there statistics about how effective it is? I mean, are kids learning?
Absolutely. And they actually beat, I mean, they need to go through obviously, state tests and all of the things that any other school needs to go to, and they beat the standard scores by a percentage, and they also show great results in people that graduated in terms of attendance to college. So it's definitely a very high quality group, and they fare at least as good as any other school. It's just much more engaging.
Is it effectively a charter school in New York City?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, but I had never heard of it, and when I read about it in the book, I thought, "Wow, this is a good idea." And it almost seems like the Holy Grail. Somebody in the chat room is saying he's worried that this, for instance, VR, going to Sidra in VR, Beatmaster saying, is this going to heighten empathy, or could it just lead to a false perception of normality? Could it just normalize the suffering that's going on? And you actually talk in here about the empathy game. How do we heighten empathy without inoculating people or getting people inured to the suffering?
Yeah, I think that it's a good question, and you have it with news as well. You know, we see suffering on the news all the time, and sometimes we do get less sensitive or, you know, overwhelmed. At the same time, I think that if it's done well and designed well, and if we come with the right expectations, what we could do in VR is get you to be there and generate empathy because you understand better the other perspective. And again, you're not just watching it, you're participating.
Yeah.
I've been a witness to many game experiences just do that. You know, they just get people to understand the perspective much better, and they can do it in scale. You know, they can do it because it's digital. They can do it in large numbers. So, for example, you know, going back to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, obviously a discussion group can do that as well, but you have a problem of scale. How many discussion groups of that type you can do in a year? But if you do it through a video game, if you do it through a VR experience, and you do it well, the scale is much different. You know, you can literally reach millions of people.
So as James Paul Gee says on the back of the book, Power Play is the definitive report on the growing success of the movement to make games for change. It's happening already, and there are case studies in here about people who are doing it right, and kind of how it's working. The book is called, and it's, by the way, it's really fun to read, very well written. Power Play: How Video Games Can Save the World. And wouldn't it be the best of both worlds if it were fun? And you learned and you developed empathy. If world leaders could maybe play these games like Peacemaker before they have to solve these problems, wouldn't that be, what a nice idea that is.
You know, there is a, if I could tell you a quick story.
Sure.
There was one Israeli politician that agreed to play a Peacemaker on national TV in Israel.
Wow.
And I think that he probably regrets it, but he decided to play on a prime time news the news broadcast. He narrated his actions, and there was a camera that took it over the shoulder, and he lost the game in 5 minutes. And the reason he lost the game is that he took a series of military actions without even regarding the other side, without even thinking, you know, that he needs to balance it with other diplomacy actions.
Right.
And when he lost the game, the reporter is asking him, so how realistic you think the video game is? And he said, this game is completely unrealistic because I did all the right things.
Ah.
And that tells you something about why we were in this situation for so long.
I did everything right.
Yeah, that wasn't right. I retaliated. This is what I should have.
Well, and I think you could always say something like Peacemaker. Well, the assumptions the game designer made are, you know, politically biased and they don't reflect the reality or whatever. But I think it's also very interesting just to line up what your options are and see what some of the consequences are.
Absolutely.
And I built settlements on the West Bank, and you can see it didn't work out too well for me. So. I'll have to think of, something else.
You're pretty good with the Israeli side, but you're not doing very well on the Palestinian side.
The Israelis love me.
They love you. Yeah.
I'm a minus 70 now in Palestine. Not so good.
Exactly.
This is really fun. I encourage people to check this out. The company that Asi started and created this game with is no longer his, so... you're not benefiting Asi from this, but it is really interesting and really fun. And this is the same as the way it was when you designed it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know, again, I would be the first to admit that the game right now is old-fashioned. I mean, I would probably approach it differently. But at the same time, you know, it's still one of the prominent examples of taking something very complex politically and trying to make it very realistic and sophisticated in a video game.
Is anybody doing, for educational purposes, a fake news game to help kids develop critical skills in understanding what they're reading?
I haven't seen it yet. I think it's a great idea. And I think that someone is probably working on it as we speak.
I'll talk on Wednesday to Jeff Jarvis, who's part of this Tau Foundation group that's working on integrity in the news. I think that would be a good way to put some of that money to work.
Absolutely.
Yeah, really interesting. The book Power Play, How Video Games Can Save the World and Still Be Fun. Asi Burak has been our guest. Thank you, Asi, for joining us. Really interesting stuff.
Thank you.
And keep up the good work.
Thank you so much.
Before we go, is there somewhere people can go if they want to get involved or they want to donate or they want to help? Where would you send people?
I would go to Games for Change. I mean... Okay. The Games for Change website, the Games for Change event, you know, it's at the end of July. Really, the most important thing to say about this community, about the book, about all those efforts, it doesn't matter if you're a gamer or you're non-gamer. You should feel that it's important because it's the most dominant medium of our time.
Right.
So,
if you had a chance at the beginning of television or the beginning of movies to influence... Yeah. Them, you would do it. You would take it. In hindsight,
absolutely.
We maybe wish we had.
Absolutely.
GamesForChange.org. Thank you, Asi. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
We do Triangulation every Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1800 UTC. If you want to stop by and watch live, join us in the chat room. It's always, you're a big part of the triangle. The guest, me, and you, please do so. But I know a lot of you can't, so that's why we make this show available on demand everywhere. You are audio or video. You can watch if you want. It starts at our website, twit.tv/TRI. But you can also find that at anywhere you get your podcast. And I know many of you listen in the air. We're on a lot of airlines. And if you are, thank you for listening. And I hope you'll go to twit.tv and find more great programming along these lines. There's a lot of shows in Triangulation. We also, I'm very pleased to say, are nominated for an episode of Triangulation we did some weeks ago for a Webby Award. This was the conversation I had with Edward Snowden's attorney. And I'd love the vote. We only have a few more days. The voting ends April 20th. And we've made a short URL you can use to get there. This is the People's Voice Award. I think this is the first time they've done podcasts for the Webbies. If you go to twit.to/Webbies, WEBBYS 2017, twit.to Webby's2017, I would be very grateful. And thank you for your vote. And thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on Triangulation. Bye-bye.